newest chapter of the Council on American Islamic Relations, which is a chapter of the largest civil liberties and advocacy organization for Muslims within the United States. And I'm very honored to be here today to give you a very unique presentation on Muslims within the United States history and also about current civil rights issues that are going on today within the United States and even perhaps a little bit abroad as well. For us to get started, this is an extremely important topic. And it's a topic that I've been thinking about for years, actually. And when I first started to think about it is when I was in middle school. When I was in middle school in eighth grade on September the 11th, 2001, I remember going into my social studies classroom. And when we got into the social studies classroom, the teacher sat all of us down and they said something happened today, something monumental, and that is that the United States has been attacked. And then they turned on the television and then they showed us the attack that occurred on September the 11th at that time. And what that did for me is, you know, I was probably the only Muslim going to this middle school in Kirkwood, which is only about 5 minutes away from here. I was probably the only Muslim at that time. And everybody knew I was Muslim because I didn't eat pork. Every month I would just stop eating and I would just be in the cafeteria every single day just hanging out. Like, why are you not eating? Well, that's just what I do. And people knew it, but they didn't really know what it meant to be a Muslim. And honestly, I didn't really know what it meant to be a Muslim either. One of the unique realities that came out this tragic day is they gave American Muslims the opportunity to discover themselves in order to explain their own history, where they came from, and what their religion preached and what it did not preach. So this is the first experience and time in eighth grade that I realized that this would mark what I would be doing in the future as well. When I went to college at Drake University, I was telling the young man here, I went to college to study astronomy, physics, and mathematics. So I took nuclear particle physics and quantum mechanics and these types of classes. But then while I was there, something remarkable happened. And remarkable, I mean tragic. During that time, you also had upheavals going on within the United States. The organization I work for, CARE, we actually follow and track Islamophobia within inside the United States. And what we discovered is after 2001, there was a rise sharp in Islamophobia, basically anti-Muslim crimes or anti-Muslim rhetoric in public spaces. And that spiked up after 2001. I mean, that makes sense because a very terrible attack happened that was blamed on the majority of Muslims across the world. But then after 2001, especially 2003, that spike went all the way down and hit rock bottom. And it basically stayed like that until around 2009 or 2010, and then it spiked back up. Now that's very odd. If you think about it, why would an issue, which is, you know, hatred against Muslims, go up after September 11, which is logical, go down, but then in 2010, would shoot back up. And what we discovered is that a series of incidents started taking place within inside of America that brought this issue to the forefront and brought this issue to the forefront. Some of you, actually probably all of you, remember these issues, such as Pastor Terry Jones burning down Qurans within Florida, you know, burning the Quran trial and then doing public burnings of the Quran. You also had within New York City an Islamic community center being built about 2.5-3 blocks away from Ground Zero, but yet it was dubbed the Ground Zero controversy. And there are people on both sides of the controversy. I'm not gonna argue one way or the other, but that created controversy across the United States and it really divided people. And you also had this new notion coming in within inside the US that Sharia law, Islamic legal jurisprudence that governs the legalistic affairs and also the spiritual affairs of Muslims in Muslim countries, being stated that this is going to take over the United States, overthrow the Constitution, and basically become the law of the land, which is astonishing. You know, if it was actually possible that Muslims that represent 1% of the population who don't even want Sharia law to become the governing law of the United States were able within a few years to get Sharia law to become the governing law of the United States, I would encourage all political parties, all, you know, big companies and corporations to stop funding Republican Democrats and start funding that party, because they would have done something completely miraculous. But when these incidents started, it rekindled Islamophobia and rekindled hatred within inside the United States, which is why I switched from politics, history, and math into politics. Astronomy, physics, and math to politics and history. And that's why I'm still studying to this very day. When I graduated Drake University, I came to St. Louis and actually became the youngest executive director of CARE, the Council on American Islamic Relations, in its history. And while in St. Louis, I had the unique experience of being able to go to a city called Joplin, Missouri. And Joplin, for those of you know, is only about 4 hours away from here. And inside Joplin is a small community within that area. In 2011, actually 2010, 2011, there's a massive EF5 tornado that hit Joplin, wiped out one third of the entire city, complete decimation. And what's unique is Muslim Americans from across the region went to Joplin, stayed within that Islamic center, and actually on a daily basis for 2 years helped rebuild the city, helped the people in the city. We met a lot of very interesting folks within the city, but that's an entire other conversation. The tragic part was, 1 year after that incident happened, a tremendous blow happened. And that Islamic center, which I stayed in, which I worked in, we had interfaith people coming, where we had this, for lack of a better word, this Louisiana lanky 6 foot guy who had a 2.5 horsepower chainsaw who actually lived in that building for 2 months. That building was set on fire and totally burned to the ground 1 year after the tornado started. And that really hit home, because that was the first full arson attack done on any Islamic center within the United States. Before that, the Islamic center had been attacked, shot at, defamed, graffiti done. That was the first time it was completely and totally burned to the ground. That had a major impact on me because, you know, I went there. I know the people there. And I saw the building the day after it was burned to the ground. And part of the rhetoric that's used against Muslims within the United States is this rhetoric that this is a Judeo-Christian country, that Muslims have nothing to do with the nation of America, that they're just a foreign group of people coming in to the country. Which is why I think this particular topic is so vital to understanding who are Muslims and what sort of relevance and history do they have with inside the United States. And that's the topic that I'll be covering today. Now, there's a lot to cover. Fascinating stories. I'm going to keep it fairly short because we have to do our sunset prayers in about 40 minutes or so. So I'll try to keep it fairly concise and to the point. Now, there are some people, historians, that say that Muslims have been coming to the United States, I say the United States, as you mean the United States, Canada, Mexico, and South America as well, basically the Americas. And they say they've been coming to the United States even before the time of Christopher Columbus. Now that statement is actually quite contentious. It hasn't been proven yet, so I'm not going to dwell too much on that. But some of the theories are that when you look at Native American tribes, you see their outfits. They actually, some of them wear turbans. They'll actually wear the long dress that was common to Western Africa at that time. Some of the tribes, their names are Mecca, Medina, and other terms that really, it makes the mind question, how did they get these terms unless they had interaction with American Muslims? But again, that is contentious, so I don't want to talk too much about that. But rather, our story begins in Muslim Spain. For those of you who don't know, the Muslims had ruled Spain for over 800 years, much longer than the United States, been around 500 years to go before we reached that level. And the Muslims were in charge of Spain, and they governed Spain for 800 years. And within that time, you had massive wealth within Spain. And you also had a flourishing of religious tolerance. You had Christians, members of the Jewish faith, and Muslims living together without really any major conflicts going on. What's unique, though, is during the end of the Muslim rule of Spain, especially during 1492, you basically had a movement within side of Spain to kick the Muslims out and to take over Spain to be a Christian country. And part of this movement and part of this time is when Christopher Columbus was living and when he was around. So Christopher Columbus lived during a time when there was a Muslim Spain, when there was a Khalifa living and ruling parts of Spain as well. So this is the time that Christopher Columbus was living in. And this man, this explorer, he had this dream that he wanted to get money in order to find a better way to India. You know, he wasn't discovering America, rather he was discovering a new route that's a faster route to get from Spain basically to India. And it just shows that, you know, India has a special place with inside Westerners and Europeans. Everybody loves India for some reason. So Christopher Columbus was living at this time. And while he was living, he was going to Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand in order to try to get funding and try to get money in order to pay for his expedition. In order to travel across the world, you kind of need some money, you need some serious financial backing in order to do that. So he would approach these two and be like, you know, please give me some money. I've got this great idea. I want to travel across the world, discover a new route to India. Please give me money. And of course, multiple times they said, no, are you crazy? We're fighting the remnants of Islam within southern Spain. We don't have any first money to do it because all of our money is going to the war effort, nor do we have the political backing to basically pay for your expedition. And they said that Christopher Columbus, like an early stalker almost, would basically follow these two around anywhere they go, and he'd meet them in different cities and beg them for money, and they would say no and no again. In 1492, though, something amazing happened. And I mean amazing in the historical sense, maybe not in the gray sense. But something amazing and extraordinary happened, which is that the Khalifa of Spain leaves Spain. And the Islamic State of Spain basically collapses. And Christopher Columbus was there when the Khalifa at that time basically went to King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella and gave them the keys to the last major city within South Spain. Christopher Columbus was actually there. And he saw the Islamic king basically bow down to these rulers and hand them the key. And that was in 1492. Most of us, we know the famous Christopher Columbus song. In 1492, Columbus sails the ocean blue, right? So it is accurate to say that basically after the king and queen were able to conquer Muslim Spain, they also had access to the treasures and the wealth of this long dynasty, of this massive empire. And with that wealth, they used it partially to fund Christopher Columbus's expedition, which is why literally a few months after the king of the Khalifa basically gives up the keys of Muslim Spain to King Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand, is that Christopher Columbus then actually sailed to the United States. The funding literally comes from the remnants of the Islamic State at that time. Another two fairly interesting people are the Pizol brothers, and Martin Alonso Pizol and Vincent Yanis Pinzol. Does anybody remember these guys? I'm sure you said like in fourth, fifth grade. If not, I'll remind you. These two gentlemen are basically, after Christopher Columbus had the money to sail to India to try his expedition, he needed voyagers, he needed ship people, he needed captains of his ship, right? You need to create a crew. So two of the crew members he hired were these two brothers. And these two brothers are the captains of the Pinta and the Nina. You have the three ships, Pinta, Nina, and Santa Maria. Two of these captains are these two brothers. What's unique about these two brothers, though, is historically at that time, you basically had the Spanish Inquisition going on as well, which, not to delve too much into it, but basically if you were Jewish or Muslim, you got to get out of Spain. Or, better yet, convert to Christianity, and you'll be allowed to stay. So many Muslims, along with many members of the Jewish faith, converted to Christianity, perhaps not wholeheartedly, but in order to keep their land, to keep their property, and to stay in Spain. These two brothers here, the captain of the Pinta and the Nina, are actually the sons of a Muslim man who basically converted to Christianity in order to live and remain in Spain. So these people are not Muslim. I want to make that clear because there's a lot of folklore and there's a lot of this type of very interesting thesis that, you know, on the Pinta, the Nina, and the Santa Maria, that there were Muslims on the ship. There were, you know, historically there were not. But there were a lot of these people, basically people who were forced to convert to Christianity or perhaps did it wholeheartedly, and these were people on those ships as well. The last part is a few months before Christopher Columbus actually makes the journey to come to the United States, he goes to a small town called La Rabada, Spain. I'm not very good with these words, so please forgive me if I mispronounce it. La Rabada, Spain, which is actually an Arabic word, which means watchtower. And when he goes into the city, again, this is the westernmost city within side of Spain. And again, the Muslims had ruled that city for about 800 years. And he studies, or he goes into a monastery. He lives inside of a Christian monastery, basically a church, which was converted from a mosque into a church. So Christopher Columbus, a few months while planning an expedition to discover the New World, actually stays within inside of a converted mosque that's now monastery in order to plan his expedition to the United States. So again, it's just the connection that especially Christopher Columbus and Spain had with the Muslims at this time is very interesting to study, and there's a lot of interesting facets of it. Moving swiftly along, because there's a lot to cover, I want to talk to you about Mustafa Estabanaco. Estabanaco, if I said that right. So this gentleman, he's the first African who we know historically to basically be born in Africa and to be the first slave to be brought to the United States or the States at the America at the time. I stopped calling the United States. To be brought to the Americas. Now this gentleman, he was a medicine man. Basically, he was a doctor at the time. They called him medicine man at that time. And he came to the America, and he was only one of four survivors out of an expedition of 600 people. Very, very early on, and he was also a Muslim. So this is a very early on individual who came to America, who was basically brought here as a slave, but also was a medical man. And this is, in essence, the very first individual we know that was born in Africa and brought to the United States, and he was a Muslim. Let's move a little bit forward, and then we'll go back a little bit. What were the founding fathers' view of Islam? Trying to get more to the United States and more to America. What did the founding fathers think of Islam? How do they interact with Muslims? And how do they interact with Muslim countries? You have to realize the world at that time was very different than what we're used to today. The United States was not a global world power. It was just this new country with 13 colonies just starting out. And many of the Muslim countries, such as Morocco, Libya, these areas, didn't really exist. The nation state at that time hadn't been created. So the world that the founding father lived in were very, very different to what we're used to today. And their interaction with Islam was also very unique and very different as well. Starting with George Washington, in the United States at the time of the 13 colonies, they opened the first synagogue within inside the 13 colonies. And when they opened up the first synagogue within inside the 13 colonies in 1790, George Washington wrote them a letter. And I use this quote to try to help explain to you the tolerance and the way the founding fathers thought of what America would be in the future. So when he wrote these people a letter, he says, "May the stock of Abraham, who dwell within the land, continue to merit and enjoy the goodwill of other inhabitants, while everyone shall sit in safety under his own vine and fig tree, and there shall be none to make him afraid." So again, what's happening is that the first synagogue has opened within inside the colonies. And George Washington writes them a letter, in essence, you know, explain to them that their religion and their practices will be protected and will be kept safe within inside this new experiment, which is the United States. He will later go on to say, when I first heard about it, I thought it was one thing, but then I learned it to be something else. He will later on comment, he would say, he would even welcome Mohammedans to Mount Vernon, which is where basically George Washington lived. Although you don't know, George Washington was very rich. He owned a mountain, right? So he even said that he would invite Mohammedans to come. That's sort of what they thought of Muslims at the time, Mohammedans. And they had a unique term for them also, if they were good workmen. So when I first read that, I was like, wow, you know, he would even invite Mohammedans, Muslims, to come to Mount Vernon. But actually the context in which he's saying that is that he's basically saying, I would even let Mohammedans come, right? Like, you know, the extreme. I would let everybody to the United States, even the Mohammedans, to come and visit me on Mount Vernon if they're good workers. So this is sort of an indication how the early founding fathers viewed and thought about Muslims at that time. Thomas Jefferson is also another very unique individual as well in his interactions with the Muslims. Before I get to his life, though, I want to actually state this. Thomas Jefferson wrote what's called a Bill of Religious Liberty, which is inside the state of Virginia. This statute still exists to this very day. And part of it, after he wrote it, he actually gave a reason. Why did he write this particular bill? And again, in the future, Thomas Jefferson would then also go in order to write the Declaration and whatnot. And he said, "It's meant to comprehend, within the mantle of its protection, the Jew and the Gentile, the Christian and the Mohammedan, the Hindu and the infidel of every denomination." So again, the early founding fathers of the United States, they are writing about and they are talking about the Mohammedan or the Muslims at that time, saying that these people are also welcome within inside the United States. Something unique about Thomas Jefferson specifically is that Thomas Jefferson, there's this unique book out right now, it's called Thomas Jefferson's Quran, Many people don't know, but Thomas Jefferson was a law student. And part of his legal studies and part of his law studies, he was very interested in what's called natural law. And you can see natural law within the early writing within the United States. You know, all men have certain inalienable rights. What does that mean, inalienable rights? What makes a person have inalienable rights? The rights that cannot be taken away by the majority in a democratic country, cannot be taken away by the state, that these rights are God-given rights. Well, part of that thinking is what's called natural law. And Islamic legal jurisprudence, or Sharia, right, is in essence natural law. It is a law that derives specifically from a belief in the divine, that God, he has given all human beings, and not only human beings, but business transactions, animals, land rights. He's given multiple rights within inside the sacred text. And Thomas Jefferson, as a young law student, he actually was very curious about Islam in order to understand this concept of natural law within Islam itself. How does Islam view natural law, and how can we study it? And while he was studying law at the College of William and Mary, and I have a quote here, it says that his academic interest in Islamic law and religion became fascination with Islamic culture, which disposed him to include Muslims in his expansive vision of American citizenship. And Thomas Jefferson also had a translation of the Quran. It was given to him while he was in law school. And the reason I mentioned it is, again, to just remind and to give you guys a deeper understanding that the founding fathers of the United States and many of these people at that time, they had some interaction with Muslims, some interaction with Islam. In fact, even sort of the thought process as they were founding the United States, they had to think, okay, well, what is this country going to look like? When we say religious freedom, do we mean religious freedom for Protestants versus Catholic? Or do we mean it for all people? And actually what the founding fathers meant, and sort of where Muslims have a connection, is within these types of statements, within these type of sayings, and even within these actions that Thomas Jefferson had upon. And if you ever have the opportunity, you should also go and get Thomas Jefferson's Quran as well. For those of you who don't know, the first country to actually say and accept the United States to be a legitimate country. So let me backtrack a little bit. Let's say you want to start a new country, right? You basically go and you take over Arizona. So me, all of us here, we've taken over Arizona, we're starting a new country. In order for you to start a new country, you have to be recognized by other countries, right? Other countries basically recognize you, and then you become a new country. This is what's going on right now in Sweden, in France, just had a vote for the state of Palestine, for example. These are now countries recognizing the state of Palestine. America, the 13 colonies, also had to become recognized. The first country to recognize the United States was actually Morocco. Was actually Morocco, which was run, and we have two gentlemen from Libya. You guys just missed the mark. But it was the country of Morocco. It was the first country in the world to actually recognize the United States to be a country. And because then you have some very unique interaction between the United States and Morocco and the people of Morocco as well. One of them is called the Moor-Sundry Act of 1790. The Moor-Sundry Act of 1790. This is very unique because it had the president at that time, John Adams, who basically states the United States had no character of enmity against the laws, religion, or tranquility of Musliman. Those of you who are from Pakistan or South Asia, you know you call Muslim Musliman. But actually this is a Persian word, that's where it comes from. So John Adams at that time, as he's correlating and discussing sort of his presidency, he states that the United States has no character of enmity against the laws, religion, or tranquility of Musliman. Again, another statement said by one of the early presidents of the United States, specifically talking about Muslims at that time. Now I get to get to a fun story. I'm gonna get to a few individual people. I want you all to meet urban legend of the United States. If you're living around this time, all of you would know Haji Ali, or as you guys would call him, High Dolly. Right? Americans have this fascinating way of sometimes other people's names, that way of butchering it, but it catches on. So this gentleman named Haji Ali, but everybody at that time called him High Dolly. Haji Ali, High Dolly, you know, makes sense. Salahuddin Ayyubi in America is called Saladin, right? Even though that's not necessarily his name. So this gentleman is a very unique individual. He was an Ottoman subject and he's from Jordan. Do we have any Jordanians in here? No? Okay, that's okay. He's living in the Ottoman Empire at the time, and he's from Jordan. And this guy is like a folk legend, because what it happens is that he is hired by the United States Army in order to come to the United States and lead the first expedition to cross the what's known as the Great Desert at that time, or the Great American Desert, which is basically from Texas to California. Has anybody flown from Dallas Airport to LA in their life, or has anybody been that you have? So you know it is just literally like miles and miles and miles, hundreds and hundreds of miles, perhaps some of the most unforgivable desert. So the United States Army hires Haji Ali, or Hai Jali, to basically get, to get camels from the Middle East, bring them to the United States, so that way he can lead the first expedition from Texas all the way to California to try to see if they can cross the Great American Desert. And this guy at that time was known as this great folk, he's like a legend at that time because he's crossing this massive desert. He wrote a lot about his experiences crossing the desert. I don't know how much of it he's in his right mind, but this is a very unique individual. He gets married to an American lady who also converts to Islam, and he has daughters inside the United States who basically grow up. What happened to his daughters, what happened to his family later on, we don't know. Maybe they're still Muslim, maybe they lost their Islam, but this is Haji Ali. On the right you see his wedding photo, and then on the left you also see his tomb. Right down in Arizona, this is his actual grave. And just to show you what did Americans think about Muslims and Islam at that time, they made his grave, and they made the tombstone of the grave a pyramid, and on top of the pyramid is a metal camel. Right? And if you go into the small town Arizona, they swear that this is the hottest tourist attraction in that small town to this very day. Of course, I would argue, well, what else is there in this small desert town of Arizona to go and see? But this is Haji Ali. Again, he's hired by the US Army to go and actually expand the Great American Desert. We also get into this time of slavery within inside the United States. During this time, you also have the transatlantic slave trade, which is you have 60 million Africans basically being brought by ship to the United States to have very hard and dirty slave labor within inside the country. Many of these people that are brought in were also Muslim. Again, West Africa, Morocco, a lot of these countries still have large Muslim populations as well. And I say a portion of those slaves that are brought over were actually Muslim. Some scholars say it's up to 10% were actually brought in. So literally the people who helped build at least the South, were slaves. But I want to highlight a few of their stories. This gentleman, his name is Ayub Suleiman Diallo. Ayub Suleiman Diallo, or as I like to call him, Ja Ben Solomon. So Ja Ben Solomon, like most Africans at that time, you know, he wakes up in the morning, he goes out, you know, he's chilling, he's having a good day, and then all of a sudden, literally out of nowhere, men come from the brush, they basically hit him over the head, tie him up, throw him on a wagon, and then the next thing he knows, he's a slave inside the United States. Now this gentleman, though, he's extremely intelligent. He knows how to read and write, which at that time was a miracle, almost nobody knows how to read and write. And he's brought in as a slave into the United States. And this guy was very smart, he's very witty, and he's very clever. To make a long story short, he's brought in 1731, he's brought in. And somehow he's able to basically earn his own freedom from being a slave. And not only does he earn his own freedom, he's then invited to the United Kingdom to actually sit with the royal family and meet King George II, right? So again, you've got this guy in Africa who goes out one day, gets kidnapped, brought to the United States, works in slave labor, gets his own freedom, and because of intelligence, because of his wit, he's able to get his own freedom and meets King George II. What's unique about this gentleman is he left biographies for us that we still have today that are mainly, that are basically written in Arabic. And what's more miraculous is that he wrote by himself three entire Qurans from memory. That means when he was in the United States, from memory, he actually rewrites three entire Qurans in Arabic, which are still preserved in museums to this very day. Astonishing feat, because within the Islamic tradition, people would memorize the Quran. So the first Qurans brought to the United States were not brought necessarily by books or whatnot, but they were actually brought by these slaves who basically had the Quran memorized, and when they came here, they would actually write. And the earliest transcripts of the Quran in Arabic that we have in the United States are handwritten Qurans written from memory by people like Ayub Suleiman Ayub Suleiman or Job Ben Salman. He's also witty. What do I mean by being witty? This is a side tangent. And I think the Muslims will appreciate this, but people of other faiths might not like it. But I'll say it anyway just because I think it's kind of interesting. So when he's with King George II, basically the court wants to paint it. You know, at that time they have painting. I'm sure you've seen the extravagant paintings of the kings at that time and whatnot. So the painters come up to him and like, you know, Ayub, I would like to paint you in your native traditional dress. Do you by chance have it on you? And he's like, no, I don't have it on me. I mean, I was just walking outside, somebody hit me on the head, brought me here. I didn't, you know, carry a suitcase with me when I was brought here this late. You know, that of course I don't have it. And they're like, well, okay, that's a problem. He's like, okay, no worry, this is what you'll do. I'll describe to you my dress, and then you can draw me wearing that dress. And they're like, you know, how can we paint something that we can't see? And immediately when they say that, and this is an Islamic sort of like theological thing, I don't know if you ever debated Muslim, but they always like to do some things. So again, they said, how can we draw an outfit if you never see it? So immediately he responds, if you can't draw a dress you never saw, why do some of painters presume to draw God whom no one has ever seen? Right? This is like a theological debate he gets into these people. It's sort of on the side, but basically when he's in King George's palace, you know, everywhere around you can imagine, he sees pictures of Jesus, he sees pictures of the cross and whatnot. So he basically, in this very witty way, argues with them. Another gentleman that's very unique, who's brought here by the transatlantic slave trade, is Abdurrahman. And this gentleman's a very unique story because he is actually a prince living inside of Africa who gets brought here as a slave. Oh, so cute. So he's literally a prince living in Africa, and during a battle, I know everybody's looking at it, I can't see the next movie. Hello. So he's literally brought in as a slave into the United States, literally, and he's a prince within that area. During a battle, his army loses and he's captured and he's brought over and he's brought into the United States as a slave, and he basically soared in Mississippi.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, probably don't want to touch that. There's a power up to the back here. So he's brought in here as a slave, and he's basically sold inside the Mississippi. What's unique about this individual is that, what's unique about this individual is that he is extremely intelligent. Again, he's a prince, he has the best education, he's not only very well educated, he's also a natural leader. So the person who basically buys Abdurrahman, he calls him prince and he makes him the head of his plantation. And what the hell about Abdurrahman? He basically creates one of the largest plantations in Mississippi. Abdurrahman, during his lifetime, was told to write letters to Muslim countries, basically inviting them to Christianity, inviting them to accept the gospel. But what he does, and he's told to write these in Arabic, but what he does in, and I guess an act of resistance, is rather than writing a letter inviting people to Christianity, he actually writes the first chapter of the Quran, which is called Surah Fatiha, and he sends that overseas. Another aspect about Abdurrahman is that he's able to write a letter to the Sultan of Morocco. Again, Morocco, the first country to recognize the United States. He's able to write a letter to the Sultan of Morocco, explain to him his situation. The Sultan of Morocco then, at that time, contacts the United States President and the Secretary of State, asking them both to release Abdurrahman, you know, the prince from Africa. And John Adams, who was the man taking on this case and secretary, then petitioned inside the United States to have this man be free. And him and his wife are actually freed, and they're let go. Unfortunately, the story ends kind of tragically because their children are still enslaved within Mississippi. So then him and his wife go on a fundraising campaign to try to raise funds to get their children free. They're unsuccessful to get them all free, but they are able to get two of them free. And Abdurrahman returns back to his home country, and then 4 months later he passes away. So again, there are some of the probably thousands of stories or millions of stories that are out there of Muslims who were involved in the transatlantic slave trade, who came here as slaves, but some of them were able to gain their freedom. Of course, the majority, or actually almost none of these Muslims, were able to keep their religion. Many of them became Christian when they came to the United States, or just as time goes on, their religion just, you know, goes away. If you don't have an Islamic center, if you don't have scholars to teach you the religion, within a few generations, your religion will basically disappear. So even though maybe 10% of 16 million were Muslim, none of that really translated into our modern era of that type of Islam coming to our modern day. Moving on though, I would like to introduce you to another gentleman. His name is Edward Wilmot Blyden. And this individual is a very unique person because he's the father of what you would call Africanism. And what this movement is at that time is basically a movement to get Black Americans inside the United States to connect with Africa, to create Pan-African connection. You know, if you would study at that time, and even in the United States during the civil rights movement, there's a big push of everything Africa. Like, we're going to go back to Africa. You know, a lot of people would even fly to Africa and they burn their passports when they got to Africa. This guy is the founder of that movement. And a lot of his writings were widely disseminated at that time. The part that's interesting, at least in our narration, is that in 1889, he converts to Islam. And he actually immigrates to Liberia and became the Minister of Islamic Education in Liberia. And while he's in Liberia, he writes this book called The Christianity, Islam, and the Negro Race, which highlights sort of his conversion to Islam and also the concept of Africanism. So again, one of the founders or the founder of Africanism within that time, also the man who would later convert to Islam and then become a teacher in the Ministry of Islamic Education. Moving beyond and trying to get more into our modern perspective, and we're almost finished, and we have to take a break for evening prayer. The modern concept of Islam is basically in two main categories. The first category is with the Nation of Islam. The Nation of Islam is a movement that was started by basically Wallace D. Muhammad and also his student Elijah Poole, who basically become Elijah Muhammad. And the Nation of Islam at that time is sort of a movement that wanted to create its own Black nation within the United States. That Black people can never integrate, they can never be a part of a larger American population, so rather than trying to integrate, they should separate and create their own country or their own land within the United States. For our purposes, though, the Nation of Islam was the first time in modern history that Americans by and large heard Islam. They by and large heard the name Muhammad. We all know the boxer Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali was also part of the Nation of Islam as well. What Muhammad Ali did, he was able to basically get the name Muhammad and make it a household name within the United States. He was part of that movement. Malcolm X was also part of that movement as well. And this is sort of the early modern understanding of Islam inside this country. In fact, the United States today, 1/3 of all Muslims living within the U.S. are actually Black American Muslims, meaning that they are Muslim because of the Nation of Islam, because of their teachings, and then they convert to Orthodoxy Islam. So this is the first half of it, the first stage of basically the modern movement of when people would know about Islam within the United States. Something unique about this movement, though, is Martin Luther King and other civil rights leaders at that time, they preached integration, that, you know, Black people and others should all live together in harmony and peace. You have to understand that this was not a very, for lack of a better word, not everybody agreed with that logic. You know, you had lynchings at that time, you had Jim Crow laws going on. So not all Black people said, let's hold hands, sing Kumbaya, and yes, we shall overcome. There's a large segment of the Black population at that time who said that the United States will not accept us. And many of them moved into this religious identity of Nation of Islam. And that leads to our last stage, and I'll wrap it up with this. In 1965, you had the Immigration Act. Before 1960, you know, you wonder, why are there so many immigrant Muslims inside the United States? How many of you are Muslim, but you're from a different country? Or you're initially from a different country in this office? Okay, I would imagine all of them here. You might think, so why are there so many immigrant Muslims inside the United States? And why is this more of a recent phenomenon? And why haven't there been large segments of immigrant Muslims living within the U.S.? Well, the reason is because the United States, before 1965, did not have what we would call fair immigration practices. Well, what happens is that before 1965, if you lived in Europe, or specifically if you lived in Western Europe, you were given a quota, you were given a higher chance to come to the United States versus if you lived anywhere else in the world, especially China or Japan, because there are a lot of Chinese that were coming into California at that time. So before 1965, you had the United States preferred to have Western Europeans come and live within the U.S., and everybody else basically had a much lower chance of coming in. After 1965, though, they passed the Immigration Act, which for the first time made it fair. Anybody, anywhere in the world, you have the equal opportunity to come to the United States. And actually, after 1965 is when you see the large population of immigrant, especially Muslims, coming to the United States. And that's also when you see, let's for example, in the city of St. Louis, in the 70s, you have the first Islamic center being started by a group of Muslim students who went to St. Louis University. They started West Pine Islamic Center, or Masjid Bilal, or Gateway Mosque. They had like three different things. So these are students who came to the United States after 1965, after the Immigration Act passed, which allowed Muslim students to come to the U.S. equally and fairly. And when these students first came, they created this Islamic center. Of course, since that time till today, you have large population of Muslims coming in within the country as well. To conclude, oh, I passed my last time. But to conclude, I'll accidentally open up the class. So to conclude, as I began, I first started this discovery of Muslims involvement within the United States after September 11th and after also the Joplin Islamic Center was burned to the ground. When the Joplin Islamic Center was burned to the ground, the man who burned it down, he basically wanted one statement to be said, which is that Muslims are not welcome within inside this country. That I'm burning this down and it's a show that you are unwelcome and that we don't want you here. What's amazing about America, though, and amazing about the tower that struggles to build, is that 2 years after that Islamic Center burned down, it has now been rebuilt. And it has now been rebuilt in this, you know, much larger building, and the community has been able to not only rebound from that tragic event, but then been able to build bigger and larger. And I think this is something fundamental to our future as Muslims and people of all faith within the United States, that even tragedy strikes one group of people or one segment of the population, that the will of the country is such that there's an opportunity for it to go bigger, to go back, and inshallah, God willing, I'll continue with that.